have the right equipment. You don't ever improvise. Don't have a cobra in a room. Okay, well, I don't have a snake tongue, so let me go and get a coat hanger or banana or something like that. It doesn't work. The right equipment, first of all, I make use to contain a snake. I make use of a snake bucket or a snake tube. And the reason for that is that once they're in there, there's no chance of you accidentally getting bitten. You know, you can't, in bags, we use bags when we go do field work and that. But I know of at least two cases where herpetologists were killed being bitten through a bag. Snakes bite through bags. So you don't want to mess with bags. That's looking for trouble. The handling goes, we use either a tongue or a hook stick. Opposite. Now, the hook sticks I only use on puff adders because puff adders are so fat. The snakes, we use snake tongues. And snake tongues are designed in a manner that you cannot easily hurt a snake. They're geared so that you don't put too much pressure on them. Now, for training and for today, I prefer using the longer tongue because it just gives you a much more distance between you and the snake. It just makes it so much safer. When I work with puff adders, I prefer to use a bucket because you can pick them up, put them in the bucket. And this bucket is very specific. It has a lid with a center handle, so I don't have to put my fingers near the bucket and get bitten with the snake inside. It uses a bit of a shield. The bucket is clearly labeled, so you know that there's a snake in there. And once I get the lid on, the bucket tips closed. So all of that is really, really important. So the first snake I'm going to show you is a puff adder. And this is quite a nasty individual. It really enjoys biting. There we go. That's an average-sized puff adder. Now, as I said, when we catch a snake like a puff adder, we're going to use one of the two containers. For now, I'm going to use the bucket on this one. Now, if you recall, I mentioned the striking distance. Regard the striking distance as the length of the snake. The snake is just under a meter. So if I'm over a meter away from the snake, I'm perfectly safe. So the idea is to have your container ready. The hook stick is just over a meter long, so it gives me a very safe distance. I don't really have to go like this and be off balance. This is perfectly safe. When you approach a snake, don't be concerned about where the snake is looking. Quite often people will come here and they have to hand the snake, oh no, hang on, it's looking at me, let me walk around this snake. It doesn't matter, it'll keep on looking at you. So what you do is you get the hook under the snake, and once you hook the snake, you've got to pick it up. If you get the hook under the snake and you keep it there, it just goes off the hook. And the moment the hook's under the snake, you've got to point it up. You can't hold the hook like that. It's going to fall off. So I get the hook under the snake, I gently pick it up, not too high, because it's got far to drop the higher I pick it. So there I've got the snake on the hook. And I very gently put it, I don't drop it into the bucket. I gently put it down in the bucket to get the hook out. And quickly get the lid on before it comes out of the bucket. And we're done. So now you've removed the problem snake, you have it in a container, now you have to deal with it. Don't leave it flying around. Don't leave it at a lodge at reception where the receptionist wants to show her mother and all that sort of jazz. People are going to get bitten there. The moment you contain a snake, you deal with it. Put it in a vehicle. You drive a few kilometers away, not 500 meters, it might come back then. Go a few kilometers down the road and drop it off in the neighbor's property, something like that. Okay, and the releasing is easy. You open the bucket, you can just chuck it down and off goes the snake and you're done. You've dealt with it. I don't have breathing holes in here. You're quite often I'm dealing with spitting snakes. And the handling of spitting snakes is exactly as we're going to do today. The difference is you've got to wear decent safety glasses. Not your cool Ray-Bans where the venom can come in through the top and the sides, but something that seals off nicely. So if you have a snake kit, have your kit, your tongue, and have not just your safety glasses, but keep a torch handy as well. Often you have something under a bed or in a cupboard or in a container, stuff like that. So they see the tube as an escape place. And these tubes work phenomenally well. And if they're going a bit slow, you can touch the tail. If you touch the body, they come flying out again. And then you sort of get someone to see, is it safe? Yeah, it's safe. And you put the tube on. It's a simple as that. Works incredibly well. Any of you guys doing, the idea is that you will need to lift the bottom half of the snake off the ground so that it has no traction, and then get it by the tail and suspend it on the snake hook. And you'll see snake park, experienced snake park staff doing this all the time. So you put the body well off the ground, you get the tail, and now I'm suspending it in a manner that it can't get near me or bite me in any way. So I'm just going to do this once more. So what they do with tailing is they lift the body off the ground, and then while it's off the ground, get it by the tail, and not too far forward, because the tail might twist around your hand and then it has an anchor. So you go quite far back in the tail, and that is the action. A little bit cool, he's going to heat up shortly, and then we'll have So what I'm going to do is very gently pick him up at the middle of the body. Now with a long tongue it's quite nice, you can support the tongue. Pick him up, not too much pressure. It's a close to the head for my liking. And my idea is to come this side of the tube so the snake escapes away from you. And you literally got to get that head just into the tube. With a bit of luck, you might go in there. And then, as I said, don't touch the body, you touch the tail. And then once he's gone all the way in, I'm going to come and help you. You're going to pick it up, and I'll say, yeah, it's safe, and you put the lid on. Easy. So the snake doesn't have traction. Lift the body off the ground. Okay, try that again. By the tail. And I've got him on the hook. Just do that once more. Okay, so here we go. Place the body off the ground, get the tip of the tail. And there we go. Okay, the other thing that happens at snake parks is quite often it's necessary for them to neck a snake because they might want to do some surgery, it might have parasites, it might have some sort of problem. And very often with necking we use a clear acrylic tube. Let the snake crawl up the tube, and when it's halfway up, you grab tube and body so the snake can't go forward or backwards, and you can see what you're doing. But we don't have acrylic tube. Of course, the problem with necking is that you dramatically increase the chances of an accident. You dramatically increase the risk. So we really nowadays, and not just that, we find that it's extremely stressful for the snake to neck them. So we really try and minimize that. But pretty much what we do is get it behind the head with the tongue. Then grab there, and there's a very specific grip where I've got a finger on the head and one on either side so it can't turn around and bite me. Now quite often with necking, guys will have their forefinger under the head with the thumb on top of the head. But snakes like puffers and gaboon adders are known to bite right through the lower jaw and get you. So there we go. Very, very firm grip, very safe grip. But yes, necking is often unnecessary. It is stressful to you and to the snake. So we try and minimize the necking. Right, we have another pebble. If I had a season's riches, I could live with being poor. When I tail him is I get as much of the body off the ground as possible, to make sure they don't have good traction. And I'll try and go towards the tip. You see what he's doing here? Yeah. Once they do that, they have a grip, and then you have trouble.
Yeah.
Slippery
one. And then just on the
necking. So what I do is get him behind the head to let him reverse. And finger on the head.
Show this to Teal. No, any kiss.